దూరవిద్యా విధానంలో డాక్టర్ బిఆర్ అంబేద్కర్ ఓపెన్ యూనివర్సిటీ దేశంలోనే మొట్టమొదటి సార్వత్రిక విశ్వవిద్యాలయం. దాదాపు 2.5 దశాబ్దాలుగా దూరవిద్యా విధానం ద్వారా కంప్యూటర్ కోర్సును అనుసంధానం చేస్తూ బీఏ, బీకాం, బీఎస్సీ డిగ్రీ కోర్సులను అందిస్తోంది. పోస్ట్ గ్రాడ్యుయేషన్ స్థాయి, డిగ్రీ, డిప్లొమా స్థాయి కోర్సులను ఔత్సాహికులైన విద్యార్థులకు అందిస్తోంది. డాక్టర్ బిఆర్ అంబేద్కర్ సార్వత్రిక విశ్వవిద్యాలయం స్థానికంగా స్వయం బోధనా పద్ధతిలో ముద్రణ రూపంలో రూపొందించిన కోర్స్ మెటీరియల్ అందిస్తోంది. కోర్స్ మెటీరియల్ అధ్యయనానికి సహకరించే విధంగా రేడియో, టెలివిజన్ పాఠ్యాంశాల ఆధారంగా కార్యక్రమాలు ప్రసారం చేస్తోంది. అధ్యయన కేంద్రాల ద్వారా ఏర్పాటు చేసే సలహా సంసర్గ తరగతులు, సైన్స్ ప్రాక్టికల్ సౌకర్యాలు విద్యార్థులకు స్వయం అధ్యయనానికి ఒక చక్కటి అవకాశం. ఇవి విద్యార్థి సమీపంలో ఉండే అధ్యయన కేంద్రం నుంచే పొందొచ్చు.
Today we will discuss biofertilizer techniques. Before discussing into details of the biofertilizer techniques, let me introduce myself as Professor B. N. Reddy, retired head department of botany, Usmania University.
I am Dr. Sudha from Vanita College, associate professor, department of botany.
I'm Dr. Sabita Rani, head department of botany, Usmania University College for Women, Koti, Hyderabad.
Food, clothing, shelter, these are the three essential things to survive on this globe. So, among these three, food occupies the key position. To feed the global population of more than 900 billion people, we have to provide the sufficient food for this growing population. The only way to feed this 9 billion people is to provide the sufficient food, for which that is cultivable land is a limited. So, that is a stagnation of the cultivable land. The only way we have to increase the food, we have to produce more food for the unit area. In this direction, there are several attempts. One thing to produce the resistant varieties, hybrid varieties, like that we can name that is father of green revolution, Dr. Norman Borlaug, and like that Dr. Professor M. S. Swaminathan. These two people helped to feed the starving people by producing the dwarf varieties of wheat. One way it helped to feed the poor people, but on the other it has increased the enormous application of the chemical fertilizers. So, to increase the more yield, the chemical fertilizer is becoming the only option. But because of more application of the chemical fertilizers, just one way it might have increased the food grains to a large extent. On the other hand, almost all the soil, water, air and all are polluted. In addition to that, the food grains, the chemical residues are remain in the food grains. Because of enormous use of the chemical fertilizers, there is an environmental problem. So, in this situation, the biofertilizer came into existence. Biofertilizer is not a new topic. Even more than 100 years back, Dr. Bejarik first time isolated the rhizobium bacterium from the root nodules of the leguminate plants. From that time onwards, many people are working on the biofertilizers and the applications. Before going to the details, now I request Dr. Sudha, can you explain what are biofertilizers?
Biofertilizers are active strains of microorganisms which can improve the soil fertility and the crop yield. And in another word, microorganisms having inputs of carrying the nutrients, capable of mobilizing the nutrient elements which are not available or usable form, can be made into usable form to the plants. So, the microorganisms are actually used the term as a fertilizer. Fertilizers are the substances we add to the soil to enrich the soil and enhance the growth and yield But here microorganisms are providing that kind of nutrients to the plants, which will increase the yield as well as increase the fertility of the soil.
So, as you said, biofertilizers without harming the environment, it will provide the sufficient nutrients for the crop plants. Just can you explain, Dr. Savita, what is the role of the biofertilizers in the sustainable agriculture?
There is an important role for the biofertilizers in sustainable management of nutrients for the crop plants. Just because we have discussed that there is a lot of pesticidal residues and other complications associated with the pesticides in the agriculture crops. So, in this scenario, the biofertilizers is a very good alternative methodology, because they can fix the atmospheric nitrogen, they can fix the phosphate, and they can also mobilize the nutrients to the plant. So, this is an important role where you can use these as an alternative to the chemical pesticide. This is the one application. The other application is, as we have discussed, biofertilizers are nothing but the microorganisms. They have not come from anywhere. They have come from their natural source, that is the soil. They are already present. Only we are taking an efficient strains. So, once these organisms, efficient strains are isolated and used as a biofertilizers, the important use is they increases the fertility and soil chemistry, soil nature. So, this is a very sustainably maintains the soil compositions. This is the one applications. And another important role is these microorganisms acts as an stimulants. We call not only biofertilizers, we call it as a biostimulant, because they stimulate the secondary metabolism of the plants. Hence, most of them acts as an disease resistant, biotic stress and abiotic stress. That means we are producing a resistant variety. So, biofertilizers acts as a fertilizers, biostimulants increasing the soil structure and nature. So, the lot of applications are there for this technology.
Okay. Dear viewers, about the biofertilizer techniques, if you have any doubts and clarifications, please feel free to contact on the following numbers. Just note down the phone numbers: 040-2703-1431, 040-2703-1432. The other number is 040-2703-1433. If you have any doubts, clarifications, please call us on these following numbers. Dr. Sudha, can you explain what are the different types of biofertilizers?
Biofertilizers are of different categories. As we told, they are the microorganisms. So, there are algal members, fungal members, and different types of bacteria as well. But based on the nutrient they provide to the plants, they are classified into nitrogen fixing biofertilizers, phosphate solubilizing biofertilizers, phosphate mobilizing biofertilizers, like that. First, we will see the nitrogen fixing biofertilizers. They are free living, like Azotobacter, Clostridium, Anabina, and Nostoc like, and they are symbiotic, like Rhizobium and Frankia and others. And phosphate solubilizing, there are fungal members as well as bacterial members, bacteria like Bacillus, Subtilis, and Pseudomonas, and fungi, different species of Penicillium and Aspergillus. And phosphate solubilizing or mobilizing are arbuscular mycorrhiza, like Glomus species and Gigaspora and Acalospora species, and different micronutrient providing biofertilizers are also there.
Again, you can look into the slide. Exactly, they are giving a gist of the biofertilizers.
Types of biofertilizers.
Just see the slide which we are displaying, and you can see, you can get all the types of the biofertilizers.
This is the list of biofertilizers, sir. What are the types we have mentioned so far?
So, as you said, algae, fungi, bacteria, these are the three major components which are involved as biofertilizers.
Yes.
Can you explain about the rhizobium, one of the first known biofertilizer? Can you explain it in detail about the rhizobium?
Yeah. Just now we have seen different types of biofertilizers, nitrogen fixing, phosphate mobilizing and blue green oligosaccharides. So among the all the biofertilizers, rhizobium is the most efficient organism for the fixing the nitrogen. First of all, why the nitrogen has to be fixed? Why there is a plenty of nitrogen available in the atmosphere, plants can use this nitrogen. But the thing is, the plants cannot use the nitrogen directly. It can be utilized in the form of ammonia, which is the basic for the synthesis of amino acids, or the plant can able to absorb the nitrogen in the form of nitrates and nitrates. So this role is taken by the rhizobium. Rhizobium is one of the important and oldest known biofertilizer. So rhizobium is nothing but it is in a solid bacterium present in the natural rhizosphere, and they form the root nodules in the many of the leguminous species. So it was a like a symbiotic relationship. What does it mean by symbiosis? Symbiosis means a mutualistic. So the bacterium enters into the root through root hairs into the leguminosity members. So there it enters and it forms a nodules, and it converts, it changes its morphology and physiology, and it converts into form of the bacterioids. So in this mutualistic approach, the plant which synthesizes carbohydrates and other food materials, it supplies to the bacteria. And the bacteria in turn absorbs the nitrogen it supplies to the plant. It is a sort of a symbiosis. You can take out any leguminous plants. You know the examples for the leguminous plants, pulses, beans. You just take out the plant and absorb the root, you can see the clearly root nodules. You can see in the picture how it looks. So you can see those and observe, and this looks like pink in color. So why these root nodules are pink in color? Because the most important pigment which is present in this is the leg hemoglobin. So the leg hemoglobin is nothing but a substance similar to the hemoglobin present in the leguminosity families. We know what is the function of the hemoglobin. Hemoglobin supplies the oxygen to the different organs in our system, in the human system and other animals. Here the similar function is taken by the leg hemoglobin. So what is the function here? The most important enzyme which is responsible for the fixing is nitrogenase enzyme. So nitrogenase enzyme cannot work in the presence of oxygen. So that is the reason that leg hemoglobin takes away the oxygen and nitrogenase enzyme becomes active and it fixes the nitrogen. So this is the mechanism operating in the rhizobium and leguminosity family. Here I can tell you that almost all of the 70 to 80% of other crops and most of the leguminosity plants fixes or converts the atmospheric nitrogen in this form. So this is among all the biofertilizers, rhizobium, which is a symbiotic nitrogen fixation, is the most important one which can fixes the nitrogen. So what about then we are thinking that it is only the leguminous plant, then what happened to other plant? There are certain organisms even that can fix the nitrogen, like Frankia. So they are fix the nitrogen, the mechanism is similar, the nitrogenase action is similar. Here they can fix the nitrogen in non-leguminosity plants. So this is important. That is the reason if you go for the cropping system also, we suggest that continuously if the every time the crop has to be changed. Like if you are using the pulses, then use the next crop rotation, because the nitrogen, the soil is enriched with the nitrogen. So that is the reason. So this is the oldest and most efficient system known altogether in case of the biofertilizers.
Dr. Sudha, she explained about the one of the best known, not one of the oldest discovery of the biofertilizer, the rhizobium, which will fix the nitrogen, which is abundantly present in the atmosphere.
Yeah.
In addition to the rhizobium, are there any other microorganisms which are also involved in the nitrogen fixation or acting as the biofertilizers?
There are two more, sir. One is Azotobacter, There are several species of Aesterobacter are found in the arable lands in the soil, but among them the most widely known and also found in the cultivable lands is the Aesterobacter crucoacum. Apart from the nitrogen fixation, it releases a lot of mucilaginous substance which enhances the soil binding capacity, in turn the quality of the soil. And another one is Azospirillum. This Azospirillum, there are 5 species of Azospirillum are used as biofertilizers, are capable of fixing the nitrogen. They are inhabitants of soil as well as they are present in the rhizosphere, and also the root cortex of the monocot member, that is grass members. So, apart from the nitrogen fixation, this particular Azospirillum, they are also enhance the disease resistance to the crop plants, as even drought tolerance they provide, and even they give growth hormones as well in the form of indolestic acid. So, these bacteria Azospirillum, in fact, they can live both in aerobic and anaerobic conditions, but the preferable condition is the aerobic condition. This is a kind of gram negative bacteria, much found in all the arable lands, enhancing the soil fertility just like the rhizobium, yes, but free living, not in association with a symbiotic association like.
So far we have discussed about the bacteria, rhizobium, Azospirillum, Azotobacter, Frankia, Pseudomonas. Yes. In addition to bacteria, is there any algal member is involved in the biofertilizer activity?
Yes, there are many algal members which are involved in this biofertilizer activity by fixing the nitrogen. Because we have seen that nitrogen is fixed symbiotically by rhizobium, and with the free living, like what madam has discussed, is the Azotobacter, and associated with symbiotic, that is Azospirillum. So these are the different mechanisms where the nitrogen is fixed. So the mechanism is similar, that is the nitrogenase activity is stimulated and it functions in the fixation of nitrogen. So in addition to this, we call it as a cyanobacteria. Previously we used to call as categorized under the algae. Now we are calling it a blue green algae, BGA. In short form we call it as a BGA. So these algal members are also capable of fixing the nitrogen. So not only the bacteria, the majority of the algal members belongs to the cyanophysi, or now we are calling it as a cyanobacteria, can also fix nitrogen, and it supplies in the form of nitrates to the plants.
Doctor, so that you explain in detail about the algal biofertilizers, you add some.
As madam already explained about algal biofertilizers, algae is predominantly 3 times more than bacteria in the soil. There are different groups of algae. As we know, red algae, green algae, blue green algae, like that. But out of all the other algal members, the cyanophysi, that is blue green algal members, are able to fix the atmospheric nitrogen. So as they are recently named as cyanobacteria, referred as cyanobacteria because they share many characters with bacteria, and they are also of gram negative type. So they can fix the atmospheric nitrogen in aerobic conditions as well as anaerobic conditions. So here we can observe one difference in the cyanophysin members with having a specialized cell in the thallus, that is called heterocyst. So the members which are having heterocyst can fix the atmospheric nitrogen in aerobic conditions, that means in the presence of oxygen. The members which are not having this heterocyst can fix the atmospheric nitrogen only in anaerobic conditions. So there are plenty of members, are actually cyanophysi members, abundantly grow in our rice fields which are enriching the soil. So the examples of blue green algae like Nastra, Cannabina, Alocera, Cytonema, Mastuocladus, these are the examples. You can see the slide, the cyanophysi members which can fix the nitrogen. Here in addition to the nitrogen fixation, there are other minerals as well, like potassium also is available from the algal members. In fact, I told like nitrogen fixation is from cyanophysi. So a little bit about a few more nutrients available from algae are potassium. These are actually derived from the seaweeds, particularly Phaeophysae and few members of Rhodophysae as well. Much use of these sea beets for the potassium enrichment of the soils are followed in France as well as Sri Lanka and Ireland for the tea plantations as well as potato and radish crops. And similarly, this particular potassium enrichment of through sea beets is also followed in China for the groundnut cultivation and for the rice cultivation in Japan. One more nutrient, that is calcium, that is actually derived from the Rhodophysae members like lithophyllum and calitamnion in the place of lime. So, main contribution of algal members, particularly the blue-green algal members, is nitrogen fixation and addition to that. So, we know that in the tropical Asian countries, since ancient time, the rice cultivation is something like, along with the civilization, it has established. So, without adding any fertilizer, the crops were cultivated earlier because of the presence of blue-green algal members abundance in these fields. So, for the first time, the significance of these blue-green algae was identified by the scientist who identified the blue-green algal members can be used as a biofertilizer. P.K. Day in 1935, he confirmed the use of blue-green algae as a biofertilizer, which can enrich the soil as well as increase the fertility. So, the blue-green algae can increase the yield from 10% to 24% in that was established in many of the agriculture universities in their studies. And Professor Venkatraman from the Madurai Kamaraj University also established the same reports, and he confirmed that the blue-green algal members can fix nearly 25 kg of nitrogen per acre in one crop season. So, the best efficient use of the blue-green algal members can enhance almost 7 lakh tons of nitrogen can be fixed in rice fields in India itself. That is the inputs of efficiency of blue-green algal members in nitrogen fixation.
Okay. As you said, in addition to nitrogen, most of the algal biofertilizers will also provide the potassium and calcium, other mineral nutrients to the host plant. But one of the highly exploited biofertilizer is azolla.
Yes.
Can you throw some light on the azolla?
Yeah. So, as we discuss right now, that the blue-green algae members like Nostoc, Anabina, Alocera and other members, they can fix the nitrogen in free living form, or they may be as a mutualistic or symbiotic with other organisms. So, if you come to the azolla, azolla is known as the water fern, which is a floating pteridophyte, and here the anabina is a mutualistic association with the leaves of the azolla. So, you can see the beautiful picture of azolla. You can see the plants which is floating on the water, and the rhizoids, and you can see the bilobed leaves overlapping with each other. This is a sporophyte. So, the important here is in the leaves, the anabina is associated, and we call it as an anabilla azolae. So, which actually fixes the nitrogen, atmospheric nitrogen. So, why this is more exploited is because simple reason, because it is a free floating, it can be grown in the large quantities in the water. This is the one important where the azolla is widely used next to the rhizobium as a nitrogen fixing organisms. The second most important reason is azolla is rich in proteins. So, this can be multiplied in the short time, many times, it will 3 to 4 days, it doubles its number size. So, it can be grown in large quantities in the trays or in the pits or in the like a field. So, you can take out this azolla and dry, and can be used as a source of protein for the cattle as well as in the poultry. So, we have a dual application for the azolla. One is as a nitrogen fixing organism, and another is a source of protein for the commercial point of view as in a cattle feed. So, because of this, among all the organisms, the azolla is much exploited As in a biofertilizers.
In fact, the slides also.
There are lot of application. It can be packed easily. The processing is easy. So that is the reason. Among all the nitrogen fixing, that's what we have discussed it, like rhizobium, azotobacter, azospirillum, and blue green algae. This mutualistic approach of Azolla with that is blue green algae is widely used as in a biofertilizers. In fact,
to which group it belongs?
It's a pterophyte.
It is a pterophyte. Fern.
Yes.
Okay. So in addition to nitrogen, calcium, potassium, even other elements like phosphorus and silicon, are there any microorganisms involved in supplying these two nutrients to the host plant? Sudha,
next to nitrogen fixation, phosphate solubilizers are another important biofertilizers group. Several soil bacteria and fungi, notably the species of Aspergillus as well as Penicillium, they are able to solubilize the phosphate. So here the main thing is in the fungal members, if you observe, like the Pseudomonas, Bacillus and Penicillium, Aspergillus species, in their metabolic activity, they produce a lot of organic acids, which change the pH, lowers the pH of the vicinity of the rhizosphere. So, the binded phosphate will be released because of the lowering the pH activity of these microorganisms, so that the soil will be getting the free ions of the phosphate. That is how it enriches the soil, the form of phosphate availability. So, there is reports from different parts of the world where these micronutrients are enriched in the cultivation of potato as well as wheat crops. Particularly, two species were identified like bacteria. One is the Bacillus polymyxa is one. And then another one is Pseudomonas striata. These are the two important strains of the bacteria which can enrich the phosphate. And one more is silicate, as you asked, silicate solubilization. This is also through bacteria, SSB we call in the short form. So there are many bacteria, again here also different species of bacillus, they can solubilize the silica. So, silicates, in the form of silicates, they will be present, aluminum silicates. So, they need to be solubilized. Here also the organic acids produced by the microorganism, that is a bacteria, they enable in a dual role. So, they make it like possible as a micro element, like they will be made, and also they are available in the form of free radical. So, the plant can utilize. So, here actually one interesting observation is that these bacillus can grow in different types of soils. There is no specific type of soil they prefer. In any type of soil they are growing. So, that is how they are providing the silicate solubilizers in the form of biofertilizers.
Okay. The advantage of the bacteria, it is omnipresent.
Omnipresent.
It don't require any specific, that is the reason we can easily exploit for the absorption of the micronutrients. So, there are many other organisms, phosphate solubilization, phosphate mobilization. Are there any fungal groups which are involved in this phosphate mobilization?
Yeah, there are many fungi which are associated with the phosphate mobilization. So, in fact, we are not calling as a phosphate solubilizing, we are calling it as phosphate mobilizing. We know that the major elements which are required for the plant is, we call NPK, nitrogen, potassium and phosphate. So, these are the major element, and even the fertilizers which mostly widely used is the NPK. So, here why we calling it as a mobilizing? Because there are certain fungi, what we call it as a mycorrhizal association. So, myco means we know that fungi, mycorrhizal means rhizoids, roots. So, is it the association of the fungal members with the roots of higher plants. They are present in angiosperms, gymnosperms and other members also. So, it is a symbiotic association with the roots. So, what is the symbiosis here? Like the plants, with its own mechanism of photosynthesis, it prepares food materials, and some of the food materials is supplied to the fungi which are associated with the roots. So here the fungi can grow deeply in the roots or may form a sheath around it, and it absorbs the nutrients including mostly the phosphate, zinc, calcium and iron it supplies to the plant. So such mutualistic approach we call it as a mycorrhiza. So mycorrhiza in short it is nothing but a association of the roots of the higher plants with the fungal members. So basically there are two types of mycorrhizal association we can see, that we call it as two types, that is the ectomycorrhiza, endomycorrhiza. The name itself indicates, endo means inside. So you can see the picture, beautiful picture, like the fungi can enter into the cells of the roots. So it will spread its hyphae in the cortex of the roots. And it forms vesicles, and these are vesicles or for the store of the nutrients. So they get absorbs all this phosphate and other minerals, and this funnel to the, that means it transfers into the plant. So based on the shape of these vesicles, there are different names has been given, like arbuscles, the shape, orchid types, ericoid types, like that. So what happens, the most widely used fungi which we endomycorrhizal fungi is the glomus and what we call acalospora. So here the important application here is they are in obligate parasite, means they can grow only on the roots. And the second type of mycorrhizal you can see on the root system, they cannot enter into that. That is the reason we call it ectomycorrhiza. They form a sheath around the roots and they absorbs the nutrients and supply. You can see the structure of the internal structure. You can finally see the mycelium on outside of the root. So this is the difference between ectomycorrhiza and endomycorrhiza. So ecto is only it forms outside, whereas endomycorrhiza it enters into the cells. But here remember the function is same. It absorbs the nutrients and it funnels the nutrients to the plants. It is a mutualistic or symbiotic association, and the widely used members of ectomycorrhiza is Psilotithes, Boletus and other. So only thing is, because they are obligate parasite, they can grow only on the roots. A live roots are necessary for culturing or maintaining these organisms. So that is the reason we call this organism as phosphate mobilizing bacteria, mobilizing organisms. So we have now, we can see the nitrogen fixing, phosphate solubilizing, and phosphate this is another, it will mobilize, it just transfers. Yes. So this is a very interesting mechanism, and in natural system you can see more than 70% of the plants are having the endomycorrhizal association, and 20% plants are having the ectomycorrhizal association. So it is already there in the system, already there in the nature, but only we have to isolate the efficient strains and can culture, purify and reuse as a biofertilizers.
As you said, this mycorrhizae as a phosphate mobilizer, particularly endomycorrhizae, which will spread the mycelium far off. That root zone is somewhere here. Yes. The mycelium will spread in and around the root. Resist, so that is the reason it will identify the phosphorus and bring back to the host plant. Yeah. Because mostly the phosphorus, maybe it is in not in the dissolved form, rock phosphate. Phosphate is there, but plants cannot absorb on its own. Then the role of the mycorrhiza will come here. As you said, no, they cannot grow in the living host, then how you can overcome this problem to produce more amount of mycorrhizae? Because they you cannot produce in the laboratory, in the synthetic conditions.
No, it cannot be grown, but it can be grown in three different ways. Either in pot culture, where we can grow the mycorrhizal on plants in pot culture, or we can use the live mycorrhiza and the live roots. Or from the plants collected from the field. So these are the different ways where we can use as an biofertilizers.
So in the recent past we are hearing about this PGPR. Can you tell about what is PGPR, Dr. Siddhar?
Growth promoting biofertilizers. So far we just mentioned there are nutrients which enhance the growth and yield in general and soil fertility. So, here specifically some of the microorganisms can enhance the growth as the growth promoters. So, the microorganisms which can enhance the growth, those are called as growth promoting mycorrhiza or microbacteria here. So, they are actually rhizobacteria. In the rhizosphere they will be present. So, they can fix either nitrogen or the phosphate. So, along with that, as earlier also we mentioned that they can enrich the soil as a biofertilizer, they can help the plant, and also they can add the growth promoting substances like indolastic acid, gibberellic acid, and these are substances, cytokinins are also released by these growth promoting bacteria. That is one interesting thing. And ethylene production is inhibited by these methods. They are called as growth promoting biofertilizers, sir.
So, there is a phone call. Tell me, what is your doubt?
Hello.
Hello.
Good afternoon to all professors.
Thank you. Tell me.
My small question. Now, every day we are using this chemical fertilizers now.
Yes.
In society. So, the indirectly we are taking toxins through the, we are injecting toxin every day in the form of food.
Yeah.
So, why the governments and the government both are the failure? If they are not considering, you make a cluster for every 100 acres and provide 5 crores for the fund. And simultaneously the people will be get the, if you give the one cluster and 5 crores for every village, simultaneously their reservation their land, na? Why you are not implementing? While the technology is there, the everything infrastructure is there, professors are there, why the proper channel is not there? Will you please elaborate?
Okay, as you said, so, to feed the growing population, we have to increase the sufficient food to feed the 130 crore people in our country. So, as I said in the beginning, the cultivable land is very limited. We cannot add land anymore. Only thing, we have to produce more food within the available land. In such a situation, as you said, the technology is very perfect. We know the perfect technology. So, that we cannot completely avoid the chemical fertilizers in one go. As you said, gradually, technologically, particularly biofertilizers, so it is not very that difficult, but still there are many limitations. So, as you said, government should come in a big way to support the young entrepreneurs, particularly unemployed, educated youth. They are ready to start small units to produce large quantities of the biofertilizers. Government should come in a big way, not only to support the young entrepreneurs, also the agriculturalists. Otherwise, it will be the same situation even after 50 years from now. There is a small progress, but still chemical fertilizers are occupying the major scene as far as the fertilizers are concerned. I can still agree. The only thing, government should take it very seriously to promote the biofertilizer technology. I think in a span of time, gradually, if not completely eliminate the chemical fertilizers, at least to certain extent as a supplement, if not completely substitute the chemical fertilizers. It is a very good suggestion.
It takes time, sir. It takes time. The people are realized the significance of biofertilizers. So, some young farmers are actually taken up organic farming by using these biofertilizers. So, we can hope for the future like more of biofertilizers in the place of chemical fertilizers.
As you said, even consumers are very aware because everybody is looking for the organic food. So, that is the reason, don't think that people will accept whatever they get in the market. They are very health conscious about the chemicals food that are found in the food.
Food is.
I think people are very clever what to take or what to not to take. Then, are you happy with the answer? You have any more queries to? Okay, coming to the
sir,
main.
Sir, 1 minute, like
yeah.
We need to show that slide, sir, plant growth promoting rhizobacteria.
Yeah.
So, which we explained, the bacteria which provides growth promoting substances like gibberellin, cytokinins, and the indolastic acid. So in the picture you can see the different constants provided by the bacteria to the plant in the form of growth promoting, disease resistance, as well as the nutrient as in the form of biofertilizer. So and more importantly, they inhibit the ethylene production also. Okay. So only the growth enhancing substances like they can act. So in the picture we can clearly see what are the components are available through the bacteria.
Yes. Please, what is your doubt?
Hello. Yes, sir. Yes, madam and professor.
Tell me.
Hello.
Tell me.
Where did this technology, the common, this is because the farmer is not 10 plus 2 also, not the 10th class also educated. This is a technology oriented now, every system is totally technology oriented. So in that aspect, how did so many in India and state maximum are unemployed? This is one of the platform that the employment generation. So where did these people, this technology, we get this all information regarding this?
Later part of our presentation, we have addressed those things also.
I would like to add.
So she will answer your question.
Actually, sir, it is the technology which is not required any graduation or any education. Actually, this technology for development of the microorganism, we need this. But for the multiplication, for example, we take about the Azolla. Azolla, just you take it from the agricultural offices, agriculture universities, and universities which are working on these organisms, you can take a just off cage of this Azolla, and you can multiply in a tank, in a field. It is less how do you just multiply the crops? Actually, there are not much publicity, but people are already there using silently, and that too not an educated. These are the farmers. Especially if you go in the most of the Asian countries, as madam already has pointed out, Vietnam, China, Sri Lanka, and in India, and especially in the southern plant, there are almost 20 to 30% people are using Azolla and blue green algae especially, and the rhizobium also they are using. So, and Department of Biotechnology, which is the major research organization of India, also started a national networking project on biofertilizers. So, it is starting, the project already started, and majority all the agricultural universities are producing, doing the research, and efficient strains are producing. They are also conducting the training programs for the progressive farmers. So, if any one farmers which is coming forward to acquire this new technology, you can approach the agricultural officers which are available locally, and they will guide you, sir. This is a wonderful question. Actually, this technology should be implemented only with the farmers, because they are the basic level who are using this fertilizers. Yes. So I think I have given some inputs. Anybody is interested, you can just go and inquire about the agriculture officers which are there in the district and regional level.
But even they can contact agriculture universities, they will get the material.
So, it is not a very big technology, a little bit of training. Even around Hyderabad, nearly 30 to 40 small units where they are producing the biofertilizers. The agriculture labor in around the villages, they will involve, one technician will help in the mass production of the biofertilizer. Otherwise, you need not be a PhD or a master in that particular subject. Anyone can do it with a little bit of investment, and you can get very good profits if you go for biofertilizer multiplication. So, can you add, the main problem is how to multiply in a large quantity. You need a large quantity of the culture. So, if you apply in a field level, how can overcome this problem?
To substitute the chemical fertilizers, we need large scale production of biofertilizers.
We need large amount of the biofertilizer, because not this 1 acre or 2 acres. Yes. We need hectares of land. So here, the multiplication in the commercial scale of the biofertilizers is mainly at 3 stages. Number one is the identification and isolation and the growing of the cultures which are efficient. So, this has will be taken care by the universities or agriculture universities. So, they will that we call it as a mother culture. Mother culture means a starting point where they have identified. So, that is the first stage. And the second stage is development of the carrier methods. Carrier methods material means which is mixed with this culture, because you cannot just transfer the organisms as such. So, it has to be mixed in the carrier method materials. So, the first one will be taken care by the universities, and the second method you can multiply in the small scale industry level. The carrier methods material which we are using is locally available at the soil, vermiculite, or any other farmyard manure, cow dung. This material is mixed with the mother culture or original material. So, here the important something which we required for the selection of carrier material is, one thing, it should be locally available, it should be cost effective, that means it should be cheap, otherwise it is not possible in the large scale. And third important character is, it should not have any adverse effect on the microorganisms, and it should have a normal pH, not acidic or basic. So, these are the some which we will take care at the large scale production further. So, once you have identified the carrier material, make into a powder and mix the mother culture or broth into the culture. So, I will just show you the photograph where the various stages involved in the, you can just look into that various stages, like a broth or the stock culture, mother culture, which is multiplied and produced in large quantities in the bioreactor. This is up to the level of an agriculture universities. So, after that it is carrier mixed with the carrier material, and once it is mixed, it is dried and packed ready for sale or the commercial production. So, this is the steps involved in further rhizobium, azospirillum, azotobacter, all nitrogen fixing organisms. When coming to the mycorrhizal, I told you that mycorrhizal is obligate parasite. We cannot grow in the culture. So, the material which you use as for the mycorrhizal is the rootstocks or the pot plants where the soil is mixed with the rhizobium, and this can be used as for the commercial purpose. When it coming to the azolla, it is very easy. The azolla plants are already flea floating. You can get the plants and then you can multiply in the trays or the beans or the pits, or even with the dual culture with the rice plants. Rice plants dual culture means just inoculate the azolla plant into the rice field. It will grow along with the rice. So, you need not have any separate structure for multiplication. So, these are the different methods utilized for the commercial production of the bacterial as well as the mycorrhizal as well as the azolla plants. So, I can say that among all, the rhizobium and azolla easily can be taken up by any person with have a little bit of training on site, without any techniques or without any education or anything. You just can multiply it and use it. It is using in most of the fields also.
Okay. After mass multiplication, how to apply these biofertilizers at the field level, Dr.
Sudha? Application methods of biofertilizers, there are three common methods, sir. One is a seed treatment, and another one is root dipping, and a soil inoculation or treatment. So, soil seed treatment is the most commonly followed method for the use of biofertilizers or any of these alternate microorganisms. So, which is very cost effective as well as effective measure also, because the seed material is directly treated with the liquid form of the microorganism. So, smaller quantity, the maximum 5 kg of seed also can be mixed with the microorganisms container, which is. So, right from the germination time, the microorganisms will be with the plant. That is the best way. So, here one can use not just only one type of microorganism. So, we are not sure whether it can suit with to the plant or the soil, other conditions as well. So, to avoid that risk, 2 to 3 types of microorganisms are mixed, so that we will get the inoculations. So, another method is root dipping. This is mostly used for the plants where we are, we do the transplantation, like the rice crops or the vegetable crops, where we take out the seedlings and again transplant. So, here like the required amount of the microorganisms inoculation is taken in 5 to 10 liters of water. So, the plants are dipped, that is the root dipping, that is what we call. So, the roots are dipped in this water at least minimum of 30 minutes prior to the transplantation. So, the root system is inoculated here, that is one method. And another one is soil application. This is directly in the field. Directly in the field we can inoculate. So, here the amount of the substance to 200 milligrams we can add. So, instead of directly adding to the field, because they are microorganisms, they need to be spread out to the entire field. So, they are mixed up with the farmyard manure or organic matter. For 200 grams, it is 200 to 400 to 600 kg of farmyard manure plus rock phosphate, half bag of rock phosphate also added. And this will be kept for at least minimum of 24 hours for the fermentation to mix up these microorganisms well with 50% moisture content. So, this can be just spread out in the field while plowing or making the channels along with our agronomic practices. So, these are the three different methods we follow for the application of biofertilizer.
Depending upon the situation, yes, sir. We will apply the what type of
which is suitable for
the technique is required.
Yes.
So, we can produce in large quantities, there are efficient ways of application, but are there any limitations in the biofertilizer production or in the technology?
Yeah.
Any difficulties or shortcomings as far as the technology is
so
concerned?
We know that any technology has some limitations.
Yes.
That holds true for the biofertilizers, but we have to consider here there is a lot of applications of biofertilizers. That is, it is completely like stopping the uses of pesticides,
fertilizers.
So, it is an alternative. So, there are certain limitations, like the major limitation is the storage, because we are dealing with the live organisms, it should be maintained the viable, then only it works.
Yes.
So, the maintenance of the viable depends on the storage conditions,
shelf
that is
periods.
The shelf life. So, every organism has some shelf life. So, this is the one limitations we are having, and another limitation is like the production. So, some seasons we require a lot of amount of the biofertilizers, some demand is more, we have to scale up to their demand.
Seasonal,
especially seasonal applications. So, these two, and there are some other, but if you have gone for the advancement of the technology, the more you use, the more research will go on. The more research, more efficient strains and the limitations will come down. This is for the every technology. And I just want to add that we are talking about the biofertilizers. So, how much really this fixes? We are talking about nitrogen fixation, we are talking about phosphate solubilization. We just see, I will just show the statistics, like how much it will fix. You can just see in the slide that if you see that different biofertilizers, you can see that rhizobium can fix up to 40 to 250 kgs of the nitrogen per hectare. That means the half the uses of the nitrogen fertilizers. You can see how beautiful the technology means, you can minimize the use of 50% of nitrogen.
Yes.
This is the most efficient. If you further research, more efficient strains can be developed. And you can also see the Azolla, which can fix 40 to 60 kg. There is no technology is required.
Okay.
You just throw
grow
or just grow the Azolla along with the rice.
Yes.
You will get 60% of nitrogen. So, these are the positive way. And you can see Azotobacter, Azospirillum, phosphate solubilizing, where you can fix 20 to 40 kg of nitrogen and phosphorus. That means we are almost off for 1/4 of pesticides we are minimizing. That is a wonderful technology we have to take in further, so that more and more by fertilizers can be used for the agriculture and for the crop improvement.
Can you answer that? Some more advantages of biofertilizers?
Actually, as the limitations, no limitations, sir. Actually, this is a naturally available fertilizer. One can use in a best way. Only, as we know, there is a lot of research is taking place in all the fields. So, here only the gap between the lab and field. We know all these things, the data we can get, how much they can fix the atmospheric nitrogen, how best they are. Only thing, it is not reaching the actual user, that is the farmer, they are not reaching. So, that gap need to be filled, and there are a lot of scope is there, sir, biofertilizers, as we all already understood. Here I would like to add one point, like as the green revolution demand the lot of use of chemical fertilizers as well as the hybrids are usually disease sensitive. So, they need lot of pesticides also. Because of this use of lot of chemical fertilizers and pesticides, so much of pollution has taken place already, and chemical fertilizers in fact cannot be utilized by the plants fully, as the data is given only 40% of the fertilizers will be utilized by the plants. So, the remaining will go waste and that will pollute the environment. Yeah. So, here the biofertilizers are slowly, they are biological forms, and they slowly release the nutrients in the soil. So, no leaching out, no excess amount, and once we have used the biofertilizer, it is going to enrich the soil for years together. So, they even enhance the quality of the soil. As we know, the best states of wheat production like Punjab and Haryana, where there lot of excess use of this indiscriminate, excess more than better word is indiscriminate use of fertilizer. Now, there is a stagnant phase, salinity has increased and no production, less yield they have noticed. So, it is the biofertilizer which can improve the soil quality, which is also essential, not only supplying the nutrients, the soil quality need to be maintained. As in the beginning you have told, sustainable agriculture is only through biofertilizers, which is going to be, as one of the caller asked, it is going to be in future definitely an alternative to the chemical fertilizers.
And this is one of the constraint of the organic farming also.
Yeah.
Like now we can label these products under organic products and sell.
As you said, chemical fertilizers is not the ultimate, because chemical fertilizers to certain extent it may promote the growth, but finally it will pollute the environment. I think biofertilizers, I think in the future, not just they will act as a supplement to the chemical fertilizers because of the advanced technology and biotechnological tools. I think in the future, biofertilizers will completely substitute the chemical fertilizers. Now, every consumer is concerned about their health. So, everybody is looking for the organic food. I think the day is not very far to get the large scale application of the biofertilizers. Only thing, the government should come in a big way to support the young entrepreneurs, and they give subsidy to the farmers. I think in all aspect, technologically, biofertilizers, we can do it wonders with biotechnology.
It is,
I
an
think
eco-friendly
in future,
technology, sir.
Green technology. So, and there are many advantages. We can easily overcome these shortcomings if the government is very serious. We can do wonders by using the biofertilizers. Thank you.